Hello everyone, welcome to online CET class. Today I am going to discuss the very important chapter, that is thermal properties of matter. From this chapter we will get nearly 2 to 3 questions in a JEE as well as in NEET examination. So now let us discuss the synopsis on this chapter. After that, I am going to solve some multiple choice questions. So in thermal properties of matter, mainly we are going to concentrate on heat and temperature. So first we have to know what is heat. So we know that heat is a form of energy. Right? Heat is a form of energy. And here, this heat can be transferred from one part of a body to another part, or we can transfer from one system to another system only when their temperature should be different. See here, heat is a form of energy, and this energy can be transferred from one system to another system only when there is a temperature difference between them. Suppose if both the systems are having same temperature, then there is no transfer of heat energy, right? Only when the temperature is different, then only we can transfer the heat energy. So heat energy can be transferred from higher temperature body to lower temperature body, right? Now here heat is measured in terms of joule. This is the SI unit of heat energy. Because heat is a form of energy, energy SI unit is joule. So the SI unit of heat energy is joule, and the Celsius unit of heat energy is calorie. Then we can observe the effects of heat. What are the effects of heat? So there are three main effects we can observe here. In the first case, you can observe heat expands a body while cold it contracts. That means when we supplied heat energy to the object, so that time expansion of the object takes place, their size and shape that will be increased. When the same heat is released, that means if the temperature is very low, then you can observe that cold can contract the object. Heat expands a body while cold contract the body, right? Then heat increases temperature of a body. Yes, we know that when we supplied heat energy to the object, so automatically temperature of a body go on increases. Then third point, heat changes the state of a body. So we know the three states, that is solid, liquid and gases. So when we supplied heat energy, that can change the state of a body. That means we can convert a solid into liquid, or liquid into gas, or liquid into solid. So we can change the state of a body when we supplied heat energy. So these are the main three effects of heat. Remember, when we supplied heat, expansion of a body takes place. When there is a cold, then contraction of the body takes place. Then scales of the temperature. See here, temperature is a physical quantity. So this temperature can measure the degree of hotness or coldness. Whether the object is hot, whether the object is cold, that is easily measured by temperature. So here there are three different scales of temperature, and they are Celsius scale, Fahrenheit scale and absolute scale. So there are three different scales of temperature, and the third scale is absolute scale, or we can also call it as Kelvin scale. So here the first scale is Celsius scale of temperature, and this Celsius scale was introduced by the scientist Andrew Celsius in the year 1710. In this scale, so remember, the lower point is 0 degree Celsius and the upper fixed point is 100 degree Celsius. That means when I am going to consider this Celsius scale, the lower point start with 0 degree Celsius and the upper point start with, that will be having 100 degree Celsius. So this is Celsius scale, and remember there are totally 100 equal divisions in this scale. This Celsius scale was introduced by the scientist André Celsius. The lower point is 0 degree Celsius, upper point is 100 degree Celsius, and it is equally divided into 100 parts or 100 divisions. Then each division on the scale is called 1 degree centigrade or 1 degree Celsius. So you can observe here, in this scale lower point is 0 degree Celsius, upper point is 100 degree Celsius, and it is equally divided into 100 divisions, and each division on this scale we can call it as 1 degree Celsius. So the melting point of ice is 0 degree Celsius and boiling point of water is 100 degree Celsius on the Celsius scale of temperature. So lower fixed point we take it as 0 degree Celsius, this is melting point of ice, and the upper point is 100 degree Celsius and this is boiling point of water. So this is about Celsius scale of temperature. Then second one is Fahrenheit scale of temperature. So this scale was introduced by Gabriel Fahrenheit in the year 1717. Then in this scale of temperature, the lower fixed point is 32 degree Fahrenheit and upper fixed point is 212 degree Fahrenheit. Lower fixed point in Fahrenheit scale is 32 and upper fixed point is 212 degree Fahrenheit, and in this scale, so here it is divided into 180 divisions. See here, Celsius scale is equally divided into 100 divisions, but in Fahrenheit scale, so here it is having 180 equal divisions. And here melting point of ice we can take it as 32 degree Fahrenheit and boiling point of water is 212 degree Fahrenheit. So this is about Fahrenheit scale. Now the third one is absolute scale of temperature. Absolute scale was introduced by the scientist Kelvin. In this scale, the lower fixed point is 273 Kelvin and the upper fixed point is 373 Kelvin. So lower point is 273, upper point is 373 Kelvin. That indicates again there are 100 equal divisions in absolute scale of temperature. And here whenever we are going to convert Celsius scale into Kelvin, that is in absolute scale, remember 0 degree Celsius in Celsius scale, which is corresponds to 273 Kelvin in absolute scale. Suppose if you are going to convert from Celsius to Kelvin, if it is having T degree Celsius temperature, then easily we can convert into Kelvin by adding 273. T degree Celsius corresponds to T plus 273 Kelvin. Right, then, or if it is having 1 degree Celsius, then we can write 1 plus 273, that gives 274 Kelvin. So this is conversion of Celsius scale into Kelvin scale or absolute scale. So remember, there are three scales of temperature: Celsius scale, Fahrenheit scale, and absolute scale of temperature. Then come to this conversion from one scale of temperature into another scale. See here, so it is very important to remember these equations or these formulae to convert one scale of temperature into another scale. The first one is, we are going to convert from Celsius to Fahrenheit. Celsius to Fahrenheit, when you are going to convert, so you can use the equation. So degree Fahrenheit, the given value is equal to 9 by 5 into degree Celsius plus 32, right? I am going to convert the value into Fahrenheit scale. So given value is in terms of degree Celsius. You can substitute here. So using this equation, we can convert Celsius to Fahrenheit. Similarly, Kelvin to Fahrenheit. So Kelvin to Fahrenheit means in terms of Fahrenheit, F equal to 9 by 5. So here we can write K minus 273 plus 32. Then Fahrenheit to Celsius. So that is C equal to 5 by 9, F minus 32. And Celsius to Kelvin. So directly we can write K equal to C plus 273. So in reverse order, Kelvin to Celsius, then C equal to K minus 273. Then last one, Fahrenheit to Kelvin. So K equal to 5 by 9, F minus 32 plus 273. So you can remember these formulae. Directly you can convert from one scale temperature into another scale. Now come to the next part, that is thermal expansions of solid. Thermal expansion, that is the first effect of heat. So what is the first effect of heat? So when heat is supplied, expansion of the object takes place. That is thermal expansions of solids. Here what happens? We are going to consider thermal expansion into three types. That is linear expansion, superficial expansion and cubical expansion, or it is also called as volume expansion. So what is linear expansion? Remember, linear means we can consider length, straight line. So only one side. When length increases, suppose if I am going to supply heat energy to the metallic wire or metallic rod, so that length of that metallic rod increases. When length expands, then we can call it as linear expansion. When area expands, suppose if I am going to consider metallic plate, when we supplied heat energy, then its area increases. So we can call it as superficial expansion. Similarly, when metallic cube is heated, then its volume increases. So we can call it as cubical expansion. Remember, linear means increase in length, superficial means increase in area, cubical means increase in volume. So observe here, when a solid is heated, it expands. This is the common sentence which is called thermal expansion. But here, when a metallic wire is heated, its length increases. Increase of length due to heating is called linear expansion. Then increase of area due to heating is called superficial expansion. Then increase of volume due to heating is called cubical expansion. Now we can study in detail about linear expansion. So when the length of a solid increases on heating, that thermal expansion is called linear expansion. Remember, so when we supplied heat energy, its length increases. So here we are having the word coefficient of linear expansion, which is denoted by alpha. And what is coefficient of linear expansion? So in our regular classes, we studied in detail about linear expansion. We derived an equation. So that equation you can remember is L equal to L naught 1 plus alpha delta t. So here this alpha is itself coefficient of linear expansion. How to define alpha? So we can use the same equation. That is alpha equal to, we can write it as increase in length. You can observe here, increase in length per unit length per degree increase in temperature is called alpha or coefficient of linear expansion. That is, you can observe, it is defined as the ratio of increase in length of a rod to its original length when it is heated through 1 degree Celsius. Or directly we can write alpha equal to increase in length divided by original length and increase of temperature. Or we can write it as increase in length, we can take it as L divided by original length is L naught, increase in temperature or change in temperature we can write delta T. So increase in length, how much increase in length means we can write it as L minus L naught. Then consider a rod of length L naught. Initial it is having temperature T1 Kelvin. Let it be heated to a temperature to T2 Kelvin. So that temperature increases from T1 to T2. So that length of that rod increases from L0 to L. See, your temperature changes from T1 to T2. And so that the length changes from L0 to L. Now using coefficient of linear expansion, we can write alpha equal to L minus L0 divided by L0 into T2 minus T1. So T2 minus T1 means change in temperature. So we can write delta T. L minus L0 is a change in the length. So we can write delta L. So the equation is alpha equal to delta L divided by L0 into 1 by delta T. Or we can define alpha as increase in length per unit length per degree increase in temperature is called coefficient of linear expansion. Then equation 2 gives a linear expansion, that is L equal to L naught 1 plus alpha delta T or T2 minus T1. So this gives linear expansion equation. Then most of the metals have coefficient of linear expansion. Most of the metals are having the values of the order 10 raised to minus 5 per Kelvin. Alpha equal to, for example, 1.1 into 10 raised to minus 5 per Kelvin. Right? Always most of the metals are having alpha value in the order of 10 raised to minus 5 per Kelvin. Then the second one is superficial expansion. Superficial means when a metal plate is heated so that its surface area of the plate increases, and this thermal expansion is called superficial expansion, or we can call it as aerial expansion or area expansion. And here the coefficient of superficial expansion is denoted by beta. So how to define a beta here? Remember, we know about alpha. In alpha we considered length, but in beta we have to consider area. So here coefficient of superficial expansion is defined as increase in surface area to the original increase in area for 1 degree Celsius rise of temperature. Or simply we can write the equation beta equal to increase of area divided by original area into increase of area. See here, or we can write this equation as beta equal to A minus A naught divided by original area is A naught, increase in area. That will be delta T. This is increase in temperature. So beta equal to A minus A naught divided by A naught into delta T. That means increase in area per unit area per degree increase in temperature, that gives coefficient of superficial expansion and it is denoted by beta. Now let us consider a plate of surface area A0. Initially it is having temperature T1 Kelvin. When it is heated so that its temperature increases to T2 Kelvin, the area of the plate becomes A at T2 Kelvin. That means A naught changes to A when it is heated, so the temperature changes from T1 to T2. So the beta value can be written as beta equal to A minus A naught divided by A naught into T2 minus T1. Or A minus A naught is a change in area, so we can write delta A divided by A naught into 1 divided by T2 minus T1 gives change in temperature, so we can write delta T. So this is the equation for coefficient of superficial expansion. Then superficial expansion is given by the equation A equal to A naught into 1 plus beta T2 minus T1, or you can write A equal to A0 into 1 plus beta delta T means change in temperature. So this is all about superficial expansion. Now the third one is cubical expansion. When a solid is heated, when its volume increases, when volume of solid increases on heating, then the thermal expansion is called cubical expansion. So then here in cubical expansion, we can consider coefficient of cubical expansion, which is denoted by gamma. So coefficient of linear expansion is alpha, superficial is beta, and for cubical we can write gamma. Then here it is defined as the ratio of increase in volume to its original volume when it is heated through 1 degree Celsius. That means if the object is having volume V0 and it is having initial temperature T1. So when it is heated, volume changes to V and temperature changes to T2 Kelvin. So we can write the equation for coefficient of cubical expansion, gamma equal to V minus V0 divided by V0 into T2 minus T1. That means change in volume or increase in volume per unit volume per degree increase in temperature. So this is coefficient of cubical expansion. Then cubical expansion is given by V equal to V0 1 plus gamma into T2 minus T1, or we can write V0 into 1 plus gamma delta T. So this is the equation for cubical expansion. Remember, there are three thermal expansions: linear expansion, superficial expansion, cubical expansions. And their coefficients are denoted by alpha, beta, and gamma. So what is the relation between alpha, beta, and gamma? Alpha indicates coefficient of linear expansion, beta indicates coefficient of superficial expansion, and gamma indicates coefficient of cubical expansion. So what is the relation between alpha, beta, and gamma? So here we know that linear expansion is given by L equal to L0 into 1 plus alpha delta T. Similarly, superficial expansion is given by A equal to A0 into 1 plus beta delta T. Similarly, the next one is cubical expansion. So gamma equal to, so here cubical expansion means we can consider volume. So volume is denoted by V. So V equal to V0 1 plus gamma delta T. So using these equation, so we can get the relation between alpha, beta, gamma. So in our regular classes, we derived the equation. So from that equation, we will get beta equal to 2 alpha and gamma equal to 3 alpha. So that alpha is 2, beta is 2, gamma equal to 1 is to 2 is to 3. Remember, alpha is related to length, that means it is having only one side. Beta is related to area, so area means it is having two sides. Similarly, gamma is related to volume, so volume means it is having three sides. So that's why alpha is to beta is to gamma is equal to 1 is to 2 is to 3. Remember, we can write alpha equal to gamma divided by 3, or alpha equal to beta divided by 2, or alpha equal to 1. Right? Then, for an ideal gas, for perfect gas, we know the equation PV equal to nRT. For n number of moles, we can consider PV equal to nRT. This is perfect gas equation, or we can call it as ideal gas equation. So using this equation, we got the equation alpha V equal to 1 by T. After deriving, alpha V is equivalent to gamma. Gamma equal to 1 by T, that is cubical expansion is equal to 1 divided by absolute temperature. This is for ideal gas. Then, this is anomalous expansion of water. See here, when a liquid is heated, you can consider any liquid, when any liquid is heated, so its volume increases. When volume increases, density decreases, because we know density is mass per unit volume, both are inversely proportional. So when volume increases, density should decrease. So this is when any liquid is heated. But now come to the water. So water is having peculiar behavior. It is having one different or unique behavior. So what is that? See here, when water is heated from 0 to 4 degrees Celsius, so between 0 to 4 degrees Celsius temperature, so water is having peculiar behavior. It is having unique property. So what is that unique property? See here, when water is heated between 0 to 4 degrees Celsius, initially its density increases and volume decreases. It is exactly opposite to other liquids. So we know that when any liquid is heated, volume increases, density decreases. But when come to the water, when it is heated between the temperature 0 to 4 degrees Celsius, then density increases and volume increases only up to 4 degrees Celsius. So that the density of water we are going to consider at 4 degrees Celsius, because so at 4 degrees Celsius, density of water is maximum, that is equal to 1000 kg per meter cube. This is density of water. So here between 0 to 4 degrees Celsius, it is having different property than other liquids. And after 0 to 4 degrees Celsius, what happens? Again, water contracts when it is heated from 4 to 0 degrees Celsius, and it expands when cooled from 4 to 0 degrees Celsius. So that means after 4 degrees Celsius, water is acting like other liquids. Right? But between 0 to 4 degrees Celsius, water is having a unique property. You can observe the graph here. This is density versus temperature. So when temperature go on increases, when we supplied heat energy, temperature go on increases, so that its volume, density decreases, volume increases. This is for the liquid. You can consider any type of liquid. But when it comes to water, only between 0 to 4 degrees Celsius, what happens? So density increases, volume decreases. And after 4 degrees Celsius, again it will be same as other liquid. So this is anomalous expansion of water. Then, quantity of heat. See here, 1 calorie. This is the quantity of heat energy which is required to raise the temperature of 1 gram of water through 1 degree Celsius. See here, the amount of heat energy is required. Why it is required? To increase the temperature. Is it clear? So that gives quantity of heat. So for 1 calorie, we know the value 4.186, or which is equal to 4.2 joules. Remember, 1 calorie means 4.2 joules. In other words, 4.2 joule of heat energy is required to raise the temperature of 1 gram of water through 1 degree Celsius. That gives quantity of heat. Now this is specific heat capacity. So you can observe here, heat capacity, specific heat capacity, specific heat capacity of gases, molar specific heat capacity. About all these terms we have studied in our regular classes. Observe here, specific heat capacity. So here the amount of heat energy is required to raise the temperature of 1 kg of a substance through 1 Kelvin, or 1 gram of a substance through 1 degree Celsius. That gives a specific heat capacity. That means for specific, for the given value of mass, for the given value of temperature, how much amount of heat energy is needed, or how much capacity the substance is having. So that gives a specific heat capacity. And the quantity of heat delta Q required to raise the temperature of a substance is directly proportional to That means delta Q amount of heat energy is required. Why it is required? To raise the temperature. And it is directly proportional to two terms, that is mass and increase in temperature. See here, when mass of the substance is very small, then it requires less amount of heat energy. When mass of the substance is greater, then it requires more amount of heat energy. That's why this delta Q amount of heat energy is directly proportional to mass. Similarly, it is also depending on the temperature. When we are supplying less amount of heat energy, then increase in temperature is also very slow or less. When we supplied large amount of heat energy, then change in temperature will be greater. So delta Q is also directly proportional to increase in temperature, delta T. So delta Q is directly proportional to mass and also change in temperature. So we can write it as delta Q is directly proportional to m delta T. So we can take proportionality constant C. So this C is called specific heat capacity, right? So the equation will be delta Q equal to m into C into delta T, or specific heat capacity C equal to, we can write delta Q divided by m delta T. That means amount of heat energy is required for 1 gram of substance through 1 degree Celsius. And the SI unit of specific heat capacity is joule per kg per Kelvin. So this is about specific heat capacity. Then molar specific heat capacity. So here we are going to consider in terms of mole. The molar specific heat of a substance is defined as the quantity of heat is required to raise the temperature of, instead of 1 kg of mass, here we have to consider 1 mole of a substance through 1 Kelvin. Instead of saying 1 gram, 1 kg, so here I am going to consider 1 mole of a substance. 1 mole means molecular weight expressed in terms of grams. For example, 1 mole of water means 18 gram. 1 mole of oxygen is equal to 32 gram. So in terms of mole we have to consider, so we can call it as molar specific heat capacity. Here again it is depending on its number of moles and temperature. Then we can write the equation as delta Q equal to mu into C into delta T, right? Here, so C means again it is specific heat capacity. So mu, that indicates in terms of moles. So delta Q equal to mu into C into delta T. So we can write joule per mole per Kelvin. So here mu indicates number of moles present in m kg of the substance. So we can write mu equal to mass of substance in gram divided by molecular weight. So this is all about molar specific heat capacity. Then come to the heat capacity or thermal capacity. In general, it is the ratio of the quantity of heat supplied to the corresponding increase of temperature. That means the amount of heat energy is required to raise the temperature is called heat capacity or thermal capacity. It is denoted by S. S equal to delta Q divided by delta T. So this gives heat capacity. Then come to the next point, calorimetry. Calorimetry, it is a branch of science which deals with the study of, it measures the heat. The amount of heat is measured by this branch, which is called as calorimetry. Calorie, it is the Celsius unit of heat energy. Calorimeter, it is a device which is used to measure the amount of heat. See here, a system is said to be isolated when there is no exchange of heat energy between system and surrounding. Yes. If there is no exchange of energy between system and surrounding, then we can say that system is isolated. Here, this calorimetry, it is a device used to measure the quantity of heat. And this calorimeter consists of A metallic vessel having stirrer made of the same metal. The vessel is placed inside a wooden box having a wooden lid. So this calorimeter we used in the experiment Newton's law of cooling. In our first year practical, we studied Newton's law of cooling and we did an experiment related to calorimeter. So there we are using a calorimeter having a stirrer. So this vessel is kept inside a wooden box. And remember, this calorimeter is used to measure amount of heat. Here, now come to the next point, change of state. So state means we know solid, liquid, gas. Matter normally exists in three states: solid, liquid, and gas. A transition from one of these states to another is called change of state. That means one state to another state we are going to transfer or we are going to convert. For example, solid to liquid, that is ice to water, or liquid to gas, water to vapor. When we are going to convert one form of a state into another form, then we can call it as a change of state. See here, when solid is heated, then it is converted into liquid. Similarly, when liquid is heated, then it is converted into gas. Conversely, when liquid is cooled, then it may get frozen into solid. When a gas is cooled, then it may be converted into liquid. So that means in general, whenever there is a change of state of a body, exchange of heat takes place between body and the surrounding. Whenever you are going to convert one state of a substance into another state, that means exchange of heat takes place between them. Right? Then, in that change of state, let us concentrate on melting and fusion. At this temperature, solid and liquid state of a substance coexist together in thermal equilibrium. At particular temperature, solid and liquid state of a substance coexist. That is called melting or melting point. The normal melting point of a substance is defined as the temperature at which solid and liquid states of a substance coexist in thermal equilibrium during the change of solid state into liquid state. For example, at 0 degrees Celsius. At 0 degrees Celsius, ice is converted into water. At that point, at that particular point, both solid and liquid state of a substance coexist together. So we can call it as a melting point. Right? Then, when a liquid is cooled, it freezes into a solid. That means water is converted into ice. And this process is called fusion. So melting means solid to liquid, fusion means liquid to solid, and here at this condition both the states of a substance coexist in thermal equilibrium. Then resolution. Here it is the phenomenon of melting under pressure and refreezing when pressure is reduced. For example, skating on ice is possible on account of this phenomenon. Skating on ice takes place only because of resolution. As the skater applies pressure, ice melts into water. This water acts as a lubricant. So because of pressure on the ice, it is converted into water. So this phenomenon we can call it as resolution. Now come to the vaporization, the process of change of the state from liquid to gas or liquid to vapor is called vaporization. When water is heated, so when water is converted into gas or vapor, so that process we can call it as vaporization. Remember, at this point, so liquid and gaseous phases of the substance coexist in thermal equilibrium. So you can take the boiling point of water is 100 degrees Celsius. At this temperature, liquid and gases are coexist in thermal equilibrium. So this is vaporization. So here you can observe this temperature at which liquid is completely converted into vapor, and both the liquid and gaseous state coexist in thermal equilibrium, that is boiling point. So normal boiling point of a liquid, that means the temperature at which liquid and gaseous state coexist at standard pressure during the change of liquid state into gaseous state. For example, the normal boiling point of water is 100 degrees Celsius at sea level, that is under standard atmospheric pressure. Then it is sublimation. The process of conversion of a substance from solid state into directly gaseous state. Generally, solid is converted into liquid, then liquid is converted into gases. But in sublimation process, solid state of a substance is directly converted into gaseous state, for example, camphor. When we supplied heat energy to the camphor, initially it is a solid. When we supplied heat energy, that solid is directly converted into gases. Or you can take iodine. During the process of sublimation, both solid and vapor states of a substance coexist. Here, solid and vapor state means solid and gaseous state coexist in thermal equilibrium. Then, sublimation point means it is the temperature at which a solid is directly converted into vapor without becoming a liquid. And at this temperature, both solid and vapor states of a substance coexist in thermal equilibrium. This is sublimation. Now, come to the next part, latent heat. Remember, this latent heat is also called as hidden heat. So, what it means? What is latent heat? It is the quantity of heat which is required to change the state of a substance without any change in the temperature. That means at constant temperature, we are going to convert one state of a substance into another state. That gives latent heat. And this latent heat is divided into two types. That is latent heat of fusion and latent heat of vaporization. That means here you can convert solid to liquid or liquid to solid. And in vaporization we can consider liquid to gas as well as gas to liquid. So there are two types of latent heat. The first one is latent heat of fusion. The amount of heat required to convert unit mass of solid completely into liquid at its melting point without any change in the temperature. So, without any change in the temperature, solid is completely converted into liquid, or liquid is completely converted into solid. So, this is called latent heat of fusion. Here, the quantity of heat energy is required to convert, for example, 1 kg of ice at 0 degrees Celsius completely into water at 0 degrees Celsius without rising the temperature. You can observe ice is converted into water at 0 degrees Celsius. So, temperature is constant. Without rising the temperature, we are converting solid into liquid. So, this is called latent heat of fusion. Remember, here temperature is constant. By keeping the temperature constant, we are going to convert one form into another form, or one state of a substance into another state. And it is given by the equation L equal to Q divided by M. That is unit amount of heat energy divided by unit mass. That gives latent heat of fusion. The latent heat of fusion of ice can be written as, so this is the value of latent heat of fusion. Remember, 3.32 into 10 raised to 5 joule per kg. That is 3.32 into 10 raised to 5 joule of. This much amount of heat is required to convert 1 kg of ice at 0 degrees Celsius completely into water at 0 degrees Celsius without rising its temperature. This is latent heat of fusion. Now this is latent heat of vaporization for water, or latent heat of steam. That means liquid to gas or gas to liquid. Here again, The amount of heat energy is required to convert unit mass of a substance from liquid state into gaseous state at its boiling point without any change in the temperature. So you can say that at 100 degrees Celsius, both liquid and gaseous state. At this temperature, liquid is converted into gas or gas is converted into liquid. See here, the quantity of heat required to convert 1 kg of water at 100 degrees Celsius completely into steam at 100 degrees Celsius. That means temperature is constant or without rising the temperature. This is latent heat of vaporization. Now this is the last part, heat transfer. In three modes, the transfer of heat takes place in the nature. Heat energy is transferred from one point to another point in three different ways: conduction, convection, radiation. So I am going to consider conduction is for solid, convection is for liquid, radiation is for gases. For solid and for fluid as well as for gases, we can use three different ways to transfer the heat. The first one is conduction. What is conduction? The process of transmission of heat energy from one part of a body to another part due to their temperature difference without the actual movement of the particles from their equilibrium position. For example, if I am going to consider a metal rod, here I am going to supply heat energy from the left end. So when we supplied heat energy, so this part of the metal absorb heat energy. So when it absorb heat energy, so here the molecules starts to vibrate about their mean position. Because of their vibration, heat is transferred from one particle to another particle. So this process continues so that it reaches the other end of the metallic rod. So this is conduction process. Here we transferred heat energy from one part of a body to another part without actual movement of the particle. Particles are not moving, but they are vibrating about their mean position. So this is called conduction. So here the process of transmission of heat energy from one part of a body to another part due to their temperature difference without actual movement of the particle. So this is called conduction. Then here the most important term is temperature gradient. So that means change in temperature per unit length. You can observe, for example, it is having the distance delta x. As the distance gone increases from A to B, as the distance increases, temperature gone decreases. At the point A, temperature is very high because this part absorbing heat energy directly from the heat source. But for the point B, so this part is absorbing heat energy from the particles of this metal rod. So that as distance gone increases, temperature decreases. So this is called temperature gradient, that is given by the equation delta x divided by delta t. As the distance increases, temperature decreases. This is temperature gradient. And this is thermal conductivity. So thermal conductivity, here the amount of heat energy, the rate of flow of heat energy is directly proportional to temperature gradient across the length of the rod and the area of cross section of the rod. That means the amount of heat energy depends on four factors. It depends on A, area, it depends on temperature gradient, that is delta theta divided by delta x, and also it depends on change in the length and the time interval. So here it is totally depending on four terms. So that equation can be written as Q is directly proportional to A delta theta T divided by delta X. So instead of proportionality sign, we can write proportionality constant. Q equal to minus K into A delta theta T divided by delta X. where K is called coefficient of thermal conductivity, or simply we can call it as thermal conductivity. And this is constant for a given material. For given material, K value is constant. And the negative sign shows that temperature gone decreasing with increase in distance from the hot end. That means as the distance gone increases, temperature decreases. So the equation can be written as K equal to minus Q by T whole divided by A into delta theta divided by delta X. If area is 1 meter square, delta theta is 1 degree Celsius, and change in distance delta X is 1 meter, time elapsed or time interval is 1 second, then we can write K equal to Q. And its assignment will be watt per meter per Kelvin. So this is thermal conductivity. So while solving the problems, this equation is very important. Then the second mode of heat transfer is convection. Convection is mainly applicable for fluid. So here, the process of transmission of heat energy from one part of a body to another part due to their temperature difference with the actual movement of the particles. So here, movement of the particles takes place. You can observe here, I am going to consider a liquid contained in a flask. When this flask is heated, the layers of the liquid in contact with the bottom of this flask here, they get heated up. First, these particle or this liquid molecules will absorb heat energy. So due to the force of buoyancy, it is pushed upward. That means the liquid particles at the bottom of this flask will absorb heat energy. When they absorb heat energy, they start to move in the upward direction. The layer above, it is relatively cooler and denser, so it comes down. So these particles are moving in upward direction. The above particles are cooler, having more denser, so that it will come down. It is again get heated and goes upward. So the different layers of the liquid are in the motion and heat is transmitted throughout the liquid. In nature, the phenomenon of convection produces land breeze and sea breeze. So land breeze and sea breeze, these are the two natural phenomenon which takes place due to convection. Then the third one is radiation. So in the process of radiant heat energy is transmitted from one point to another point without the medium, without any intervening medium, directly we can transfer heat energy from one part to another part. Or no medium is required for propagation of heat energy. For example, we can get sunlight radiations. So sunlight or sun radiations are also heat radiations. Directly, the earth will get those sun radiation without any intervening medium. So we can call it as radiation. The heat energy emitted by the hot body is always in the form of EMW, that is electromagnetic wave. So this is about radiation. And come to the Newton's law of cooling. According to Newton's law of cooling, so what is the statement? The rate of decrease in heat energy or the rate of loss of heat energy is directly proportional to temperature difference between system and surrounding. That is Newton's law of cooling, and this is applicable only when a body is cooling due to forced convection. So we did an experiment regarding Newton's law of cooling. We considered hot water in a calorimeter and it is kept in a wooden box. We are using stirrer to decrease the temperature. That means forced convection process we are using to cool the water, to cool the object. So here it is, this law is completely applicable for this experiment. And it is given by the equation log of theta minus theta naught equal to minus C T plus K. So this is all about Newton's law of cooling. So this is the brief synopsis regarding thermal properties of matter. So now we can solve some multiple choice questions regarding this chapter. The first question is, a metal sheet with a circular hole is heated. Then the hole See here, we can observe this thermal expansion. We know that when heat is supplied to the substance or to any object, so that expansion of the object takes place. Heat expands and cool that contracts. So here, when metal sheet with a circular hole is heated, expansion of the hole takes place. That means the area of that circular hole increases when we heat the metal sheet, and expansion of metal sheet will be independent of shape and size of the hole. So option A is right. So hole is get larger. A solid ball of metal has a spherical cavity inside it. The ball is heated, the volume of the cavity will. Similar question here. So when the ball is heated, so that its volume increases. That means a solid ball of metal having that spherical cavity. So the volume of the cavity will be increased. That is volume expansion, cubical expansion. That will be increased. So option B is right. On a linear temperature scale Y. So here it is given temperature scale Y. Water freezes at -160 degree Y and boils at -50 degree Y. On this Y scale, a temperature of 340 Kelvin would be read as. Here it is given water freezes at 273 Kelvin and boils at 373 Kelvin. 273 to 373 Kelvin. This is Kelvin scale. Water freezes and boils at 273 and 373 Kelvin. So we know the general equation. So we can use this formula here. Reading on any scale. We can take Y scale or Celsius or any Fahrenheit scale. Reading on any scale minus lower fixed point. So we can write LFP divided by upper fixed point minus lower fixed point. So we can use this equation here. This equation is constant for all scales. This is constant for all the scales. Now we have to calculate the temperature of 340 Kelvin would be read as. How to read 340 Kelvin in Y scale? That means Kelvin is converted into Y scale. Right? Now here you can use this equation. So 340 Kelvin, this is reading on the scale, minus LFP, lower fixed point is 273 divided by. So upper fixed point is 373 minus lower fixed point is 273. This is reading on any scale. Is equal to, it is given this is Y scale, that is reading on Y scale, that is degree Y, minus here the water freezes at 160 and boils at 50. Lower fixed point is -160 divided by upper fixed point is -50, it is given, minus lower fixed point is 160. Or we can write 67 divided by 100 is equal to Y plus 160 divided by 110. So by calculating this value, we got the value of Y equal to -86.3 degree Y. So this is the value of Y. That means 340 Kelvin can be read as -86.3 degree in Y scale. -86.3 means option C is right. On heating a liquid of coefficient of cubical expansion gamma in a container having coefficient of linear expansion gamma by 3. The level of liquid in the container will. See here, cubical expansion it is given gamma, this is in a container. Coefficient of linear expansion, that is given gamma divided by 3. See here, we know that coefficient of linear expansion, so it is generally given by the equation alpha equal to gamma divided by 3. This is general equation. But from the given data here, the liquid is heating in a container. See here, liquid is heating in a container so that volume increases. It means volume expansion takes place. Therefore, volume expansion can be written as, so volume expansion is generally written as gamma, right? Gamma. So we know that, so gamma equal to 3 times of alpha. So you can substitute in the above equation. Therefore, gamma equal to 3 into gamma divided by 3. So 3 will get cancelled. That means gamma is equal to gamma. It means coefficient of cubical expansion of liquid is equal to, this is for liquid, which is equal to coefficient of cubical expansion for vessel or the container. That means the level of liquid in the container will not change on heating. So that remains constant. So here, remain almost stationary is the right answer. An iron tire is to be fitted onto a wooden wheel 1 meter in diameter. The diameter of the tire is 6 millimeters smaller than that of the wheel. The tire should be heated so that its temperature increases by a minimum of. So, increase in temperature we have to calculate. The coefficient of cubical expansion of iron, that is the value of gamma is given, that is 3.6 into 10 raised to minus 5. See here, the diameter of the wheel is 1 meter and diameter of the tire is 6 millimeter. 1 meter means it is equal to 1000 millimeter. See here, let us write initial diameter means before supplying heat energy. Initial diameter of tire. So here we can write diameter of the wheel is 1 meter means we can write 1000 millimeter minus that diameter of the tire is 6 millimeter. So this is in terms of millimeter. So we got 994 millimeter. So therefore, initial radius, so radius means it is half of diameter. So initial radius we can write r equal to 994 divided by 2. So that gives 497 millimeter. Now we got initial diameter and radius. Now change in diameter. Change in diameter. That means we can write it as delta D. So diameter of the tire is how much? 6 millimeter. And similarly radius will be 6 by 2. That gives 3 millimeter. So here when we supplied heat energy to the tire, its diameter changes. So we can write 6 millimeter and radius is 3 millimeter. After increase in the temperature, after increase in temperature, we can take increase in temperature as delta theta. Then tire will be fit into this wheel. Tire will fit onto the wheel. So increment or increase in the length of the iron tire. So we know the equation. See here. Alpha equal to delta L divided by L naught into 1 by delta theta or delta T. So we can use coefficient of linear expansion equation. Or we can write it as delta L equal to, we can write it as L naught alpha delta theta. Or substitute the value delta L equal to L naught, keep as it is. So here alpha is equal to, we know that gamma equal to 3 alpha. So alpha equal to gamma divided by 3. So we know this equation, substitute here gamma divided by 3 into delta theta. So delta L is equivalent to increase in length. So this is a wheel. So wheel means it is in the form of circle. So we can consider circumference. So in place of delta L, we can write it as circumference of the circle 2 pi r. So 2 pi change in radius delta r is equal to, this is original radius, original circumference 2 pi r into gamma divided by 3 into delta theta. Here 2 pi will get cancelled. So we can write the equation delta theta equal to 3 delta r divided by capital R into gamma. So substitute the value delta theta equal to, so 3 change in radius is 3 divided by 497 into 3.6 into 10 raised to minus 5, it is given. Substitute all the values nearly, we will get delta theta equal to, or increase in temperature equal to 500 degree Celsius. This is change in the temperature or increase in the temperature, that is option C is correct. Water of volume 2 liter in a container is heated with a coil of 1 kilowatt at 27 degree Celsius. The lid of the container is open and energy dissipates at the rate of 160 joules per second. In how much time temperature will rise from 27 degree Celsius to 77 degree Celsius? Specific heat of water is given, 4.2 kilojoule per kg. See here, container contains 2 liters of water. And when we supplied heat energy from the coil, then the container lid is open. When the lid is open, then the supplied heat energy is dissipated to the surrounding or to the environment. So dissipated energy is also given. So we have to calculate in how much time temperature will rise. See here, specific heat capacity, here the value is given, means we can use the equation. So see here, heat gained by the water and that water we kept in a container is equal to, how much heat is gained by the water? The first point, heat supplied by the coil, this is one part, minus the lid is open, so dissipation of heat energy takes place, certain amount of heat energy will be releasing to the surrounding, so minus of, we can write heat dissipated to the environment. So that gives the amount of heat energy actually gained by the water. So heat gained by the water, so we can use specific heat capacity, the amount of heat energy required to rise the temperature of a given water through 1 degree Celsius. So we have the equation directly, that is M into C into delta T or delta theta is equal to heat supplied by the coil and heat dissipated to the environment. But here it is given in terms of power, that is joule per second, means it is the rate of doing work. So here, so work means it is P into T. We know that. So P equal to W by T or W equal to P into T. So we can use this equation here. Heat, this is the power given by the coil, minus this is the power loss into the environment into time. So let us substitute the values. So M is 2 into C value is given, 4.2 into 10 raised to 3 into delta theta, that is change in temperature from 77 to 27 is equal to, and here it is given the amount of heat energy which is given by the coil is 1 kilowatt. 1 kilo is equal to 1000 watt into time, keep as it is, minus The power loss or dissipated to the environment is 160 joule per second. So 160 into time keep as it is. So calculate these value. We will get T equal to 4.2 into 10 raised to 5 divided by 840. So that gives T equal to 500 seconds. So 500 second. So 1 minute means 60 seconds. So we will get 8 minute 20 seconds. So 8 minute 20 seconds. Option A is right. A beaker is filled with water at 4 degrees Celsius. At one time, the temperature is increased by few degrees above 4 degrees Celsius, and at another time, it is decreased by a few degrees below 4 degrees Celsius. One shall observe that. See here, we know anomalous expansion of water. Water will expand in both sides. You can observe, a beaker is filled with water at 4 degrees Celsius. At one time, temperature is increased by few degrees above 4 degrees Celsius. When the temperature is above 4 degrees Celsius, water will be as same as other liquid. That means, after 4 degrees Celsius, volume of the water increases, density decreases. Then, at the another time, it is decreased by few degrees below 4 degrees Celsius. So when it is below 4 degrees Celsius, so that density increases, volume increases, so we can call it as anomalous expansion of water. So one shall observe that in the first case, temperature is increased by few degrees above 4 degrees Celsius. In the second case, it is decreased by below 4 degrees Celsius. Above 4 degrees Celsius means volume increases. Below 4 degrees Celsius means volume decreases, right? So that you can observe water overflows in both the cases, right? So option D is right. So water will expand. Only the reason is water expands on both sides of 4 degrees Celsius, right? So option D is right. Assuming no heat losses, the heat released by the condensation of x gram of steam at 100 degrees Celsius can be used to convert y gram of ice at 0 degrees Celsius into water at 100 degrees Celsius. Then the ratio of x is to y. See here, so x gram of steam, it is used to convert y gram of ice into water. There are three cases, x to y to water, means steam to ice to water. So x is to y value will be, see here, first we can write mass of steam. So mass of steam, let us write it as ms equal to, it is given x gram. Similarly, mass of water, that is mw, it is given y gram. So we know that specific heat of water, specific heat of water is, we know that 4.2 joule per gram degree Celsius. Similarly, we already know about latent heat of fusion, that is of ice, that is 334 joule per gram, and also latent heat of vaporization. Vaporization, that is of water, that gives 2260 joule per gram. So these all are constant values we have to remember to calculate the ratio x is to y. See here, heat loss by x gram. First case, heat loss by x gram of steam is equal to, we can write it as x into steam means we can take vaporization 2260 joules. Then heat is now gained by y gram of ice to become water at 100 degrees Celsius. So we can write here it is gained by y gram of ice. Ice means we can write it as y into 334. Plus, then it will become water. So water means we can write it as y into, that is for water 4.2 at 100 degrees Celsius. Now calculate this value 2260 x equal to, we will get 754 y. So x3x equal to, we will get y. So y is to x is equal to 3:1, or x is to y equal to 1:3. So 1:3, option C is right. A glass flask is filled up to a mark with 50 cc of mercury at 18 degrees Celsius. If the mask and the contents are heated to 38 degrees Celsius, how much mercury will be above the mark? Alpha for glass is given. Coefficient of real expansion of mercury is also given. See here, volume expansion coefficient for glass, we can write it as. So this is cubical expansion or volume expansion coefficient, or coefficient of volume expansion for glass is, so we can write it as 3 alpha. Then change in temperature, that is 38 and 18 degree is given. So we can write 38 minus 18, that gives 20 degree Celsius. And also increase in volume. Volume expansion means increase in volume takes place. This is increase in volume of the flask is given by the equation delta V equal to V naught alpha delta theta. So this is delta V equal to V naught alpha delta theta. Substitute the value. So volume of the mercury 500 cc into 3 alpha into 20. See here. So we know that in cubical expansion, we can take it as gamma. So gamma equal to 3 alpha. We know that. So in place of gamma, we can write 3 alpha. Substitute the value. We will get 0.027 cc because alpha value is given. So we got delta V. Now expansion in mercury. Expansion of mercury will be written as, let us take it as delta V dash equal to the same equation V alpha delta theta. So delta V dash equal to, we can write 50 into 180 into 10 raised to minus 6 into 20. So calculate this value, we will get 0.180 cc. So now we got delta V and delta V dash. So increase or apparent increase, apparent increment or apparent increase is given by 0.180 minus 0.027. So we will get 0.153 cc. So this is the coefficient of real expansion of mercury. How much mercury will be above the mark, that is 0.153. So option C is right. A bar iron is 10 centimeter at 20 degrees Celsius. At 19 degrees Celsius, it will be, alpha for iron is given, alpha value is given. So we can use the equation L equal to L naught 1 plus alpha delta theta. So we can use linear expansion. So therefore, here there are two cases. At 20 degree, a bar iron length is 10 centimeter. At 19 degree, what will be its length? So let us take L1 and L2 are those two cases. So we can write the equation as L0 1 plus alpha delta theta 1, because temperature changes here. So 1 plus alpha delta theta 2 we can consider. L0 will get cancelled. So we can write L1 by L2 equal to 1 plus alpha delta theta 1 divided by 1 plus alpha delta theta 2. Substitute the values. Its initial length is 10 centimeter divided by L2. Keep as it is. 1 plus alpha value is given 11 into 10 raised to minus 6 into initially we supplied temperature of 20 degrees Celsius divided by 1 plus 11 into 10 raised to minus 6 into, in the second case we supplied 19 degrees Celsius. So we will get L2 equal to 9.99989 centimeter. Now, so here the question is, at 19 degrees Celsius it will be, whether it is longer or shorter, so that we have to calculate. So that's why here we can write length is shortened by, because there is a decrease in the temperature 20 to 19. So we can write initially it is 10 centimeter minus. So after supplying 19 degree, contraction takes place because heat is decreasing. So 10 minus 9.99989, that gives 0.00011, or we can write 11 into 10 raised to minus 5 centimeter. 11 into 10 raised to minus 5 centimeter, it is shorter. You can observe here initial temperature is 20. Finally, we supplied 19. There is a decrease in the temperature, means amount of heat energy is here, it is decreasing. Contraction takes place, so length will be decreasing. Length is shorter. So 11 into 10 raised to minus 5 centimeter. The coefficient of apparent expansion of mercury in a glass vessel is 153 into 10 raised to minus 6 per degree Celsius, and in a steel vessel is 144 into 10 raised to minus 6 per degree Celsius. If alpha for steel is 12 into 10 raised to minus 6 per degree Celsius, then that of glass is. So here apparent expansion is given. So you can remember one equation here. I am going to consider gamma real is equal to gamma apparent plus gamma of that vessel or container. We can use this equation for glass as well as for steel. We can write here. Therefore, I am going to write it as gamma apparent plus gamma vessel. This is for glass, is equal to the same equation we can write gamma vessel. This is for steel. Substitute the values here. We can write 153 into 10 raised to minus 6, it is given. 153 into 10 raised to minus 6 plus gamma vessel for glass, keep as it is, equal to, here it is 144 into 10 raised to minus 6 plus again gamma vessel, this is for steel, keep as it is. Now calculate this value. So gamma vessel for glass, so first we can steel is given here. So gamma vessel for steel we can consider, which is equal to gamma equal to 3 alpha. So we know that 3 into alpha value is given, 12 into 10 raised to minus 6. So we got 36 into 10 raised to minus 6 per degree Celsius. So therefore, we can write in the above equation 153 into 10 raised to minus 6 plus gamma vessel of glass is equal to, we got 144 into 10 raised to minus 6 plus gamma vessel for steel we calculated, so that is 36 into 10 raised to 6. So calculate this value, we will get alpha equal to, see here, gamma vessel for glass we got 3 alpha means that will be 27 into 10 raised to minus 6 per degree Celsius. So therefore alpha equal to, we will get 9 into 10 raised to 6 per degree Celsius. So alpha value is 9 into 10 raised to minus 6 per degree Celsius. That is option A. A lead bullet strikes against a steel plate with a velocity of 200 meter per second. If the impact is perfectly inelastic and the heat produced is equally shared between bullet and the target, then rise in temperature of the bullet is. Here specific heat capacity of lead is given. See here, let us consider the mass of bullet. The mass of bullet is m. Remember, or you can assuming that the entire kinetic energy, because when we fire a bullet, it is moving, means it is having kinetic energy. When it strikes a steel plate, so that kinetic energy is converted into heat energy. The entire kinetic energy is converted into heat energy. And here this bullet will receive half of this kinetic energy. Half of this kinetic energy, here it is converted into heat energy. So we can write half of this heat energy. And so that its temperature increases or its temperature rises. See here, when bullet is fired, it is moving with a high speed so that it is having kinetic energy. When it is striking this steel plate, so that kinetic energy is converted into heat energy. In that heat energy, this bullet will receive half of the heat energy and its temperature rises. So we can write the equation heat produced. So I am going to write half of this. It is receiving only half of the heat energy. But here heat energy means it is kinetic energy is converted into heat energy. So we can write kinetic energy, that is half mv square. So which is equal to, this is P specific heat capacity. That means we can write the equation m s delta theta. Right, specific heat capacity of the lead is given here. Substituting all these values, we will get, so this is 200 divided by 4, this will be 200 square, is equal to 125 delta theta. Therefore we will get delta theta equal to 80 degree Celsius. So delta theta, the increase in temperature of the bullet is 80 degree Celsius. Certain amount of heat is given to 100 gram of copper to increase its temperature by 21 degree Celsius. If the same amount of heat is given to 50 gram of water, then rise in the temperature is. The amount of heat required to increase temperature of the copper is given 21 degree Celsius. So we can write the equation. The amount of heat energy, the amount of heat required to increase the temperature, the amount of heat energy to increase the temperature means we can use specific heat capacity. This is temperature of copper here. So we can write Q equal to M S delta T. Substitute the value 100 into 10 raised to minus 3 into 400 into 21. So we will, this is the value of what? Copper. Similarly, the second point, the amount of heat energy, the amount of heat energy required to increase temperature of water. This is for water. Let us take the temperature as delta T1 degree Celsius here. So we can write Q dash equal to M S delta T1. Substitute the value 50 into 10 raised to minus 3 into 4200 into delta T1. So this is first case and this is second case. So according to the question, Q and Q dash both are equal. This is given in the problem. So substitute the value. So Q and Q dash, Q value is how much? So 100 into 10 raised to minus 3 into 400 into 21 equal to, on RHS side you can write the value of Q dash, 50 into 10 raised to minus 3 into 4200 into delta T1. So calculate this value, we will get delta T1 equal to, we will get 2 into 21 into 4 divided by 42. That means delta T1 equal to 4 degrees Celsius. So option A is right. A hammer of mass 1 kg having speed of 50 meter per second hit a iron nail of mass 200 grams. If specific heat of iron is 0.105 calorie per gram degree Celsius and half the energy is converted into heat, then rise in temperature of the nail is. See here, we can use the equation. Already we solved one question based on this concept. So I am going to write half of the kinetic energy is absorbed here. I am going to write W equal to J into Q. That means half of kinetic energy, half mv square is equal to, that is mc delta theta. This is specific heat capacity. Substitute the values. So 1 by 2, 1 by 2 will be 1 by 4 into 1 into 50 square is equal to, this will be 4.2. It is given. So 200 into 0.105 into delta theta. Or calculate this value, we will get delta theta as 7.1 degree Celsius. So delta theta 7.1 degree Celsius, option A is right.